thank God for his faithfulness to us. I want to welcome you to today's service. For a while now, we've been talking about the VIP template, the Victory in Praise template. We are going to go one step further today as we look at the topic, a life of gratitude. A life of gratitude. Our text is taken from the book of Numbers 11. In fact, it's the old passage, but we will not read the old passage. You might just read a few. It's a story of how God fed the Israelites when they demanded meat. You know the story quite well. And how God stunned Moses by doing beyond what he could have expected. When the children of Israel, well, the group that was traveling, the mixed multitude, they were the ones that started it. They were the ones that said, when we were in Egypt, we used to eat meat. Oh, the lettuce was fine. The cucumber, it was wonderful. Everything was just fine. You want to ask them, if everything was just fine, what were they doing in the wilderness with the Israelites? And you know, that's our own attitude sometimes as well. Whenever you have to think that things were better than the way they are now, more often than not, it's because you are thinking wrong. Maybe because the mixed multitude did not go through the experiences that the Israelites went through, because they call them foreigners. Because they did not go through, the target of Pharaoh wasn't upon them, it was upon the Israelites. Maybe they were eating those good foods then. So maybe they went lying. So you can imagine when they saw the power of God, they said, this is the God of Israel. We want to serve this God. Let's go with the Israelites. So they weren't expecting. I mean, they had seen God manifest his power in Israel. They thought God would also continue the same thing. So they were there for the party. So when the party was not jumping now, it was more like sufferness. They started wondering, what is going on? And you know, some Christians are like that too. Because the church these days concentrates on blessing. Oh, come to Jesus Christ, everything will be fine. Heaven is guaranteed. Oh, you will have cars, you have this. You know, whenever I listen to the lyrics of many Christian songs, especially from my country, it's like, sometimes I nearly cry. Oh, God, you bless me for this. God, all is about blessing, nothing more. So you can imagine when people come into the presence of God, we are going to church, all they expect to hear is blessing. So when the realities of their lives now don't tally with the blessings that they're supposed to be having, they start wondering what is going on. Why? Because nobody has taught them that, look, before the blessing can come, see, God has to prepare the ground. God is a God of blessing, but he's also a God of order. He's a God of growth. He's a God of making you to spiritually mature. And what these people did not understand was that, you see, what God had in mind was not just to bless the Israelites. God's purpose was not just to take them to the promised land. God's purpose was to reveal himself unto them so that they would know him more. God was more interested in the journey that will build up the Israelites, or he was as interested in the journey as he was at the terminus of that journey, which is giving them the promised land. So you see, what was going on was the Bible says that God was testing them. God was walking around them. He kept putting them in situations, in circumstances that will reveal their hearts. And whenever it's like they will get to an unfamiliar situation and it's like they couldn't understand what is going on, God will now resolve the issue for them. When we are talking about the water of Marah, you know that God purposely led them 3 days to a place where they would not have any water. And then he now led them to a place where the only water is undrinkable. Sometimes God leads us in peculiar ways. That's why we are peculiar people. We are peculiar because we are weird. And God doesn't always follow the expectations of people. He led them to this particular place because he knew that there was water there that they would not be able to drink. And then when they cried out to God, what did God do? God directed Moses, take that tree, put it in it, it will cure it, they can drink. And from that moment, God said, look, I am the God who heals you. It was a revelational thing. So God was still taking them on that revelational journey, seeking to reveal himself to them. So that they are not just focused on the blessing, bless me Lord side. Because if the blessings are not coming, then we now say that God is not God. God wanted to show them who he is, so that they can understand who he is and serve him with all of their heart. But you know, despite all that God did, the 10 miracles in Egypt, the taking, even according to Moses' word, 600,000 men. We are not talking about women. Especially some of them, they may have more than one wife. You know that? You are not talking about children. So let's just say, conservatively, the men are 600. Then you can say the women are maybe 900,000. Let's just even say that. Maybe some some people have one wife because they couldn't afford all the wahala of Egypt. Some, they still have strength after working all day to have two wives. Let's just say that. Let's just say they had 900,000 women. That's 1,500. I can assure you, the Hebrew women were known to be very, very fat. And they were known to be very, very strong. So you can just think, you don't even want to compete the children. We are talking about close to 5 million, if not more. And God gathered them. You think about it, talk about the logistics. Think about the logic, how you can move 5 million people in one go from one place to the other. What are you going to use to feed them? Why did you think that Israelites could not even think about it themselves? They were there, they were willing to die. Under Pharaoh's whatever. Why didn't they say, come on, let's go? Because they've thought about it. Who's going to feed us? Who's going to take care of us? When our enemies come against us, who's going to protect us? You have to understand that many people, they stay in their station not because they like it, but because they don't know who's going to help them and take them out. And God did all those things for them. And he expected that after doing all these things over and over again, saving their bacon every time that they were in trouble, that at least the Israelites who understand what it is to trust him, that they will be grateful. So the topic for today is a life of gratitude. The victim in praise template, a life of gratitude. But you see, as much as God helped them, as much as God revealed himself to them, you know what these Israelites, they kept doing? They kept complaining. There was nothing God would do that would be good enough. So when it got to this point, they said, Egypt was good for us. Why are we here? God has brought us here to destroy us. And the Bible says, God was angry. Now Moses, too, started complaining. God, why did you give me this responsibility that I didn't ask for? I mean, kill me, do whatever. Because he was at the end of his tether. And I can't do anything anymore. And God now said, all right, these people, they have asked for meat. Okay, they shall have the meat they want. You see, God will give them manna in the morning and meat in the evening. And God was sustaining them in that way. But they didn't like the manna. Why? Because the manna wasn't bread. Now understand this, it's not because God could not provide bread, but because God wanted them to understand that in the status of their life, bread is not what they need at that point in time. Because bread signifies settledness, that they are in the land already. You can imagine, supposing you're supposed to be going to the promised land, and then God takes you halfway. And everything you need to have in the promised land is already in the halfway. Won't you question yourself and ask, why should I go to the promised land anymore? If everything you have is already where you are, so you stay there. So God said, look, I have promised to take you to the promised land. In order to keep you motivated and keep going, I won't give you the bread that you really want that will satisfy you. But I will give you the manna that will just fill your belly. It will keep you going until you get there. That was what manna was for. The occasional meat was just a treat. But now I said, oh, we want meat. And God said, all right, no problem. Tell them that because they've asked for meat and in the tone that they've asked for it, and for the next 1 month, I'm going to be giving them meat. And God said, God, don't say what you can't do. Yes. Looking at it, they were in the wilderness. They didn't have Tesco meat or pecan meat that they can go to. There are no abattoirs or any place where they were already raising meat to feed 5 million people. So you can understand why Moses was a bit surprised. God, why would you make such a foolish thing? Why would you want to bring yourself low before these people? You make a promise that you can't fulfill. That was what Moses was saying. So let's read it together. Let's start 11 verse 19. It says, you shall not eat 1 day or 2 or 5 or 10 or 20 days, but a whole month until you are satisfied and vomit it up violently, and it comes out of your nostrils and is disgusting to you, because you have rejected and despised the Lord who is among you and have wept before him, saying, why did we come out of Egypt? But Moses said, the people among whom I am are 600,000 footmen, that is besides all the women and children. And you have said, I will give them meat that they may eat a whole month. Shall flocks and herds be killed to suffice them? Or shall all the fish of the sea be collected to satisfy them? The Lord said to Moses, as the Lord's hands, that is his ability and power, become short, that is become thwarted and inadequate, you shall see now whether my word shall come to pass for you or not. Another version says, is my hand limited? That was what I went to bed with. Is my hand limited? Moses was somebody who knew God. Moses had seen God do things he could not even imagine. Yet when God said, I'm going to feed 5 million people meat for 1 month, it was just beyond his expectation. It was beyond what he could imagine. Feed 5 million for 1 month. And God said, Moses said, God, you can't do that. God said, I accept the challenge. You know, I started thinking about it. When issues come into our lives, don't we always limit God? The reason why we are anxious, the reason why we are depressed, is not because we can't see a way through the whole situation. Because whatever God promised at this point in time defied every logic. Moses said, are we going to drain all the fish in the sea to come and give these people? For 1 month, God didn't even say, I will mix it with vegetables. Or we mixed with this. Said, you are going to have it until it's like you don't want anymore. And what that tells us is this. We should not make the mistake of limiting God to our own limitations. As human beings, we are limited. See, that's the reason why it's like whenever you set up a company, limited by liability. But where we approach God, we should not be limited by expectations. When we limit what we think God can do, then we are not opening up ourselves to the possibility of the things that He can do. But we are human beings. We are so small. That is why we need to tap into God to be able to see the unseeable. To be able to, it's like conceive the inconceivable. Because this our God is a limitless God. Moses knew God, yet he still limited God. And God said, all right, I will take it as a challenge. And what did God do? We know that the Bible says that overnight, the Lord sent the Spirit, and the Spirit blew in the quail. And it was, by the time in the morning, the quail were three feet thick in the camp, around the camp. And people took and took and took. You know, sometimes those who doubt the stories of the Bible, you can understand them. Is it possible that you have meat that will be three feet thick? People will take and take and take. Oh, no, no, no. Bible is just fantasies. But the Bible is not fantasy. God is not fantasy. God is real. If he says he will do it, it's because he's already done it. Because he's already declared the end from the beginning. If he says you are blessed, anybody who says you are not blessed is just wasting their time. But for us to be able to see the greatness of God, we have to be able to tap into it. And sometimes, even our expectation, God will exceed it. Sometimes it's not even our faith. It's not because we don't have faith. It's just that our faith is not enough for what God wants to do. And God will say, I will do it in spite of your faith. It's not everything that God does because of our faith. Most times, God does it in spite of our faith. The Shunammite woman, did she have any faith? In fact, she said, hey, look, don't bother me about it. I'm satisfied with where I am. But God said, Moses, what's his name? Elisha said, whether you believe it or not, I have decreed it, it's going to happen. So don't let our limitation become God's limitations. Let us believe that God, even though I don't know how you are going to do it, I'm going to have to believe you for it. One of the things that I learned about Elijah's life was that when Elisha asked for a double portion of the anointing, Elijah did not say, it's not possible, but because I didn't work in it. He said, all right, you know what? What you've asked for me, I can't do it personally, but I'm going to believe God for you. I'm going to join my faith with you and trust that if you see me going up, God will give it to you. You know what he did? He cascaded it upwards to God. What you can't do, you hand it over to God. Sometimes when circumstances are overwhelming, like it was for Moses, because at this point in time, he was willing to die and retire. God says, no way. I still have a job for you to do. And he couldn't understand it. Anyway, you know what happened? The Bible says that after they woke up and as they prepared the meat, as they were about to eat it, the anger of God fell. And what happened? Many people, they died. You know why they died? It was because they forced God's hand to give them what he did not want to give them. But not just that, God was tired of their ingratitude. It wasn't because God could not do it. He could do it. But the way in which is like they forced him to that point where he had to give it to them, whether it was his plan or not, first he demonstrated his ability. Look, I can do it. Then he now punished them. May God not give us a blessing in order to then punish us after, in Jesus' mighty name. Now, a life of gratitude. We know that the Israelites were not grateful people. Because every blessing that God gave to them, they always threw it back in his face. Every blessing that God gave to them, you see, the moment that blessing ends, and they, oh, thank you, Lord God, the next thing, they are complaining. I know many of us as Christians, we are like that too. Oh, this is praise the Lord. Share my testimony. God did this. God did that. One day later, God, when are you going to do this? He's murmuring about something else again. That was what the Israelites did. They were ungrateful. Now, what is gratitude? I was looking at that particular thing. It's like using, trying to understand the English word without even going to dictionary. What is gratitude? You know what gratitude is for me? It is grateful attitude. That's what the English joined to gratitude. That's the way I saw it. Grateful attitude. You are thankful, you are grateful. But you see, being thankful is an action. Being the attitude part is feeling that comes, that gives back to that action. So, more often than not, when you have gratitude, you act on what comes from within you, your feelings. It is when praise is no longer just an action, because when you eventually see it, being grateful or having a great, being grateful to God and being, what's this gratitude? How do I frame it? Anyway, being grateful is more or less about you praising God. Praise, it is when praise goes from being action or intermittent action to becoming something that is continuous in you. Now, gratitude is the quality of being thankful. It is readiness to show appreciation to return kindness. It is when you had appreciation to thankfulness. That's what gratitude is. When you appreciate somebody, when God blesses you, say, "Oh God, I bless your name. Oh, I thank you." But it's not just once. You wake up the following day, "Lord, I bless you for what you did yesterday. 10 days, Lord, I thank you, Lord God, for what you did 10 days ago." You are still grateful. You are still appreciative. You too, look, if you keep blessing somebody at any point in time, and every time you bless them, they are always complaining to you. Tell me, how motivated will you be to keep blessing them? At the point in time, you say, "Look, that guy is ungrateful. He doesn't know how to show gratitude. No, just leave me alone." That's what he will do, because that's a human response. So you can imagine God too. He's blessed and blessed and blessed. He's shown what greatness of his power. He's destroyed Pharaoh. He's done so many things. And all these people, all they did was complain. When you have gratitude, your thought process changes. So, gratitude gives you a good perspective of things. You know, there is that story of a man there without shoes who saw somebody. No, or is it the other way? No, it's like that somebody without without shoes. Without legs, and then gradually they eventually saw somebody who was dead, and each one of them is, "God, thank you, I'm not like the other person." Understand this, there is always a seed of gratitude that God has sown into your life, something that you will look at and say, "Hey, Lord, I thank you." But the simple truth is this: our problem is that our focus, or the enemy likes us to focus on what God has not done instead of what God has done. And when we start focusing, "God, you've not done this," soon you will have what you call holy anger. And then that holy anger will turn to unholy anger. When you compare ourselves with ourselves, we look, "Look at that one. I was a senior in school. Look, he's now got twice what I've got. So what? Were you born the same day? You won't die the same day. Is your destiny the same as his?" So are you comparing yourself with each other? The simple truth is this: when you focus on what you have, then you're able to understand the perspective of God. You're able to understand where you are within the plan of God. The Israelites complained. Why? Because they thought at that point in time, everything was supposed to be jolly, jolly. Experiencing the greatness of God in the wilderness. They had expected a party in the desert. But what they got there was training in the desert. When you are grateful, you know what? You're able to understand your stage in life, because you have understanding. You know that there is a time for being born. There's a time for growing. There's a time for prospering in a particular way. Why? Because the Bible says that for everything under the sun, there is always a time and a season. God was going to give them bread. God was going to allow them to be able to become shepherds and cattle rearers, and they were able to do all those things, but at the right place. That time was coming, but they couldn't wait. They wanted it now, now, now. And when your perspective is, God, I want, God bless me now, I want it now. You know what, you're going to get into trouble. Because when God doesn't run around like your dog, you start saying, God, is this God even real? You start complaining, you start questioning. Instead of being thankful for what you have within you, you can make a choice. Say, God, this little thing that I have, I am going to bless your name for it. And it will seem as if it's like you have a million. You know, it's a human nature. I remember about 10 years ago, somebody gave us some funds and they said, okay, let's buy our son this game, PS2. Or is it PS3? And it's like, he's been asking for God knows how many, how long. I said, buy me this thing, I will never ask for anything again. Oh! We bought it. He played with it. Oh, can I have PS4? It's like that. We are human beings, we are like that. We desire something. You know, I usually realize that when I need something, anything that goes around sensitizes me to it. Supposing that, okay, I need to change my car. I'm always thinking, oh, that one is ULEF compliant. You know, look, that's just it. It's true. Why? Because it's the next thing on your agenda. And you think, oh, so everything that passes at that point in time reminds you of that thing. But you know what? The moment I get that car and it's ULEF compliant, it doesn't matter anymore. It's just another thing that is gone. Then I will not start thinking of something else. Now, understand this. Having a life of gratitude does not mean that you are so satisfied with life, you become complacent. It is you being discontent without becoming malcontent. You understand what I'm trying to say? A malcontent person is somebody who is on the negative side, destructively discontent. You are not satisfied with anything that you have. Every time, you are always complaining about things. But a discontent person is somebody who says, Lord, I bless you for the blessing that you've given me. But you know, I still need more. You know, I'm not where you want me to be. I want to get there. You have to be discontent about circumstances, or you will not seek change. If you don't have a vision for your life of what you want to do, anything will just go. And then you say, oh, okay, Sarah, Sarah, whatever will be, will be. You have to have that discontent within you. The Bible says that, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. So God expects us to keep seeking Him, to keep getting closer to Him, to keep, it's like, expecting to be the best that you can be. So having a life of gratitude does not mean is that just anything goes. It simply means that, look, whatever form of discontent you need to have within you that keeps you going for the greater things that God has for you, you've got it. But you are not complaining about it. You are saying, God, because of your promise to me, I expect great things from you. So gratitude gives you perspective. As you are more focused on what God has done for you as opposed to what you lack. Gratitude keeps you sweet with God. You should know if somebody is a grateful person, it's easier to relate with that person than somebody who is always complaining. They just grate you. They get on you. You don't want to have anything to do with them. Why? Because that's just the way they are. When you are grateful, you are sweet with God. Why? Because you know what? Your relationship with God runs better. If the Israelites, if they had that grateful heart, you know, they would have said, God, give us something extra now. This manna is wonderful. Oh, we bless your name. We are not hungry. Well, you can add some meat so that it makes it better. And God will say, okay, all right, if that's what you want, all right, I have this McDonald's in the desert. There's nothing wrong with that. You have something, you have a desire. That's fine. You can ask God. It is the attitude in which you ask it that matters. These people, they ask insolently, God, do it. It is like no reverence. And God said, all right, okay, no problem. You can have it, but it will bring leanness to your soul. When we are not humble in our approach to God, God might still answer our prayers, but there will always be a sting in the tail. The Bible says that the blessing of the Lord, it makes rich and has no sorrow to it, and there's no toiling for it. So when you are a grateful person, look, your relationship with God is always right, because you are always a praising person. And the Bible says that God inhabits the praises of his people. Let the people praise God, so shall the healthy youth increase unto you. So that is why you have to be grateful. Even if it is for a little thing, focus on that little thing. Thank God for it. Let God know that that thing, Lord God, you are grateful for it. And then that will form the basis for you asking for something else. Gratitude inoculates you against the worst of circumstances. You know, when you are grateful, you are focused on what you have and not on what you don't have. You know that even when you are going through the worst situations, it doesn't impact you as much. Why? Because you are positively focused on what is the right thing. It's something I've experienced myself. I mean, when I first came to this country and it's like things were just going from bad to worse, I started focusing on those things that God was not doing, and I became depressed. And when I realized how I got where I got to, I started asking God for forgiveness. And I said, God, help me out of this hole and I will never get into it again. And God has helped me. And I realized that a few years later, when things got from bad to worse, when things were really, really bad, you know what? I didn't know it was that bad. You know why I didn't know? My focus was just on God, on his salvation, on his getting us through it. I didn't really feel it. So even when we went through the whole thing, I wasn't bothered. Why? Because I was focused on the things that I had, that God has blessed me with. God gave me the word. So I was focused on the word. I was meditating on the word. So I didn't have time to be thinking about what God did not do or what was going on. So when you have a grateful attitude, it will inoculate you against those things that the enemy can use to penetrate your life and destroy you. Gratitude is that it gives you patience. And what patience does, patience gives you a step back. It strengthens you against all circumstances. It enables you to go through the most difficult times of your life with strength. Because your attitude, your heart is right before God. When you are praising God, it's like you start walking in a different reality. When you look at Abraham, as recorded in Romans 4, he says that there was no unbelief in his heart. He used to struggle with unbelief, but the Bible says that his faith grew strong as he gave praise to God. So when he was praising God, it was feeding his faith, and his faith was getting stronger until he was able to behold what God wanted him to see. At that point in time, Abraham could not see the impossibility of him not giving birth to Isaac. He couldn't, it got off his mind. And that is what happens. When you praise God in your circumstances, you are going to go through the situation as if it's not there. Why? Because you are persuaded in your mind that God will do whatever he said he will do. Gratitude enables you to walk in step with God. With God. You know, when you are always praising God, it means you have access to God. And what that will tell you is that you know his will. I want you to understand one thing. There are times in life when we go ahead of God. And there are times when we stay behind God. Remember that when the Israelites, when they were in the wilderness, you know, God covered them with his cloud. That place is too hot for them to be exposed to the cloud, to the sun in the desert. When you have about 50 degrees centigrade, it will roast you in time. But God was grateful. His Shekinah glory covered them during the day. And that glory, that cloud turned to fire by night to guide them. Imagine not having to pay for electricity. And you know the interesting thing about this is, whenever God says move, you know what will happen? The cloud of glory will move. Whoever does not move is exposed to the sun. So they have no choice but to quickly go and go under the protection of that cloud. It's the same thing. When you are a grateful person, you are so close to God, you know what God wants to do. When you are ungrateful, sometimes you do things before your time. Let me give you an example. The Israelites, when the sons of Samuel, they were not serving God like their father did. Samuel. Yeah. Sons of Samuel were not serving God as they ought to. They were taking, or they were accused of taking bribes. The Israelites went to Samuel and said, give us a king. And Samuel said, do you know what you're asking? I said, yes, we want a king. We want a king to rule over us like all the other people around us. And God said, okay, let me go to God first. And Samuel went to God and said, God, your people have demanded for a king. God said, give it to them. They have not rejected you as leader. They have rejected me as their leader. Give it to them. And what happened? Saul came up. And Saul initially ruled well, but to the end, he didn't rule well. You know why? It was because even if God had intended to give them a king, the one he had in mind was David. But David wasn't even born then yet. Sometimes when we go ahead of God, we are too fast. What happens is that we force God to do things he doesn't want to do. Look at Abraham too. When they decided to go the surrogate way, God had in mind, you're going to have your child 100 years old. But they forced God's thing, and he was about 83. That's when he had Ishmael. God had to make them wait another 12 more years before that time. When it's like you don't walk in step with God, you tend to do things either prematurely or when it is too late. But when you have a grateful heart, you know what will happen? God will be able to communicate to you. He'll be able to tell you, hey, don't go, stop, wait, run, do whatever you need to do to get you where you need to get to. And that way you're able to get the best of God. Gratitude empowers you to live in hope. Hope is expectation. The Bible says that the expectation of the righteous shall not be cut off. When you know that you've praised God, you are grateful for what God has done. You know that you are setting the table for the next thing that God will do for you. So you're able to live in hope. Why? Because you know that the God that has started the good work in you is faithful to complete it. So gratitude gives you hope. Also, gratitude gives you inner strength or the drive to enable you to stand your ground. You then live a life of conviction and will therefore not be easily dissuaded. Supposing the real Israelites, not the mixed multitude, supposing they had been grateful to God, do you think that when they've mixed multitude, who did not suffer what they went through, when they were saying, oh, Egypt was good, if they had been strong in their own knowledge of God, would they have been dissuaded? It's the same thing for you. Some people who don't know what God has done for you, who don't know what you are going through, they just be opening their mouth and saying things that they don't understand. And then you'll be saying, oh, yes, it is true. And then they get you into trouble with God. So you tell, look, if anybody, just tell them, oh, don't worry, my God is in control. That will shut them up. If those mixed multitude, they were complaining, and the whole body of Israel had shut them up. Would they have gotten into trouble? So when you are grateful, your stand with God is right. You are strong enough to stand for your conviction and say, hey, God has promised, God will do it. Now, if you don't want to believe me, shut your mouth off and get out of my way. You become strengthened in the Lord. And as I said, in gratitude, you can be discontent without being malcontent. So you're able to pray with a positive attitude. You're able to ask rather than complain. The right attitude, ask. The wrong one, complain. Complainingly ask, let's be that way. No, not every prayer is the same thing. There are prayers that all you are just doing is just complaining before God. God might answer, he might not answer. He might answer in a way that you don't like. Because he will say, if your attitude is this, this is what I will do for you. As human beings, don't we do the same thing? When a child comes with the right attitude and asks you something nicely, you are happy to give. But when they come with the wrong attitude and they force your hand, say, okay, is that what you want? Okay, I will give you this, but I know what is going to happen to you. So what makes you think God can't do the same thing? A life of gratitude. How does it relate to being a victor in praise? Gratitude is praise. So when you live a life of gratitude, you've already assured yourself of being a victor. It will give you victory. You will never lose. You will never fail. Why? Because you are praising God. The key is to understand that for you to be a victor in praise, your praise must go or must progress from being just an action and become an attitude. An action, you can restrict it. We are in church today, we just praise God. That is one. But you know what? God expects 24 hours praise from you. The only way you're going to be able to praise God 24 hours is when praise becomes an attitude. And then you will be a praise unto God. Understand that? These people that were complaining, they weren't a praise unto God. That's why God punished them. But when you have the right attitude, every circumstance, you have the right perspective, people will look at you and say, how can you be happy with all you are going through? I say, look, I have seen the end. I won. That's why. So you're able to see life in a different way. You, even though you're supposed to be walking through difficulties, it's like you're walking on air because God is holding you. The life of gratitude. That is how you ensure that you become a victor of grace. Let us pray. Let's pray. Attitude, gratitude is extended thanksgiving. When you are thankful to God, when you appreciate God on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, on minute basis, right? Because you are able to see what God is doing in your life. You are able to appreciate the greatness of God, the goodness of God. You are not focused on what God has not done, but you are so enthralled by what he has done and know that because he has done this, he will do that and he will complete his work within you. That's why you are grateful. So why don't you just say, Lord God, I am grateful before you today. Lord God, today, Lord God, I choose, Lord God, I decide, Lord God, that I will be a grateful person. A grateful person with attitude. The attitude of praise. Oh Lord God, I will show my gratitude. Oh Lord God, in the way that I live, in the way that I treat my spouse, in the way that I commit my business. Oh, everything, Lord God, I will show that I am a grateful person. Oh Lord God, for the greatness, for your blessings concerning my life. Oh Romoto Sokoshkiri Kasakaba. Oh Kadimo Shekere Wakansa Koshkiriya. Mila Karamato Sokoshkiri Sanda Kaba Koshkiri. Rabaromoto Sokoshkiri Sakaba. Oh Kashakaramato Sokoshkiri Sakaba. Ella Karamato Sondo Koshkiri Sakaba Koshkiri. Oh Remana Sankoshkiri Sakaba. Oh Shkiri Sakaba. In Jesus' mighty name, you are prayed. You know, when you have gratitude, you know what it means? It means that you have a system within you that is totally. And it's like quickly, how can I put it, that comes into action Whenever the enemy tries to throw his bad seeds into your life, it's like as if your spiritual radar is always at alert to see whatever is coming. And if something is not right, you reject it as, hey, this is not of God. So why don't you say to Lord God, in your name, I activate my spiritual radar that will identify anything that is not of you and reject it. Father, Lord God, you said I should resist the devil and he will flee from me. In your name, oh Lord God, ask from today any assault of the enemy upon my thoughts, oh Lord God, that will want me to sin against you, that will want me to complain, that will diminish your greatness or the things that you have done in my life. Lord, I reject them today in Jesus' mighty name. Attitude, oh Lord God, the right attitude shall be my strength, oh Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Oh Lord, In Jesus' mighty name, you are prayed. Lastly, when people complained, God did what exceeded their expectations. So you can imagine what God will do when we are not complaining, but we are praising Him. So I want you to go to this week and say, Lord God, I'm going to have a heart of gratitude. I'm going to praise you this week. Lord God, and I'm going to expect that your promise that you will do exceeding abundantly above all that I can think or imagine. By your power walking through me, I will expect it this week in Jesus' mighty name. I want you to pray. In Jesus' mighty name, you are prayed. Father, Lord, we just want to exalt your mighty name. Thank you because once again, the entrance of the world has given us light and it has given us understanding. Lord God, we now understand what gratitude means. It means that we are grateful, we are appreciative, oh Lord God, of what you have done. Lord, for the rest of our lives, let it be recorded in heaven that we are a grateful people in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord, because you've answered our prayers. For in Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Amen.